Karma is an attempt to try and talk about those issues which are related to partition, which in a sense have got completely marginalized in our consciousness. In the sense that as a second generation person, as a person who didn't have to undergo the trauma of partition myself, I've often asked myself, how exactly do I look at things which my parents and other people of their generation went through? And today, when the event seems so remote, okay, and there is hardly an understanding of what actually happened, I felt that it's not so important to try and deal with the actual events, that is actual partition, because that has been dealt with and one has an idea about that, but to try and see how a person imagines those times today. Okay, how can you reconstruct through memory, in memory, moments of the past? Okay, so basically what I've tried to do is to start with the present, take a person in the present. The protagonist, Lajma, is a person who in the present visits the sites of the past, okay, and through that various issues which are related to those times come alive all over again.
Can you sort of summarize a little bit of the narrative, the story highlights of the film in as much as the who are the protagonists, apart from this protagonist, who are the others who are in the film?
There are two main families. Okay, there's one Hindu migrant family from Lahore, which is a grocer, a Pansari, Lala Divanchand, and his family, his wife Bhagwati, and they come here and they have a child, they have a son, Gautam. They are forced to live right next to a Muslim family of an old man called Zameer, who is played by Nasiruddin Shah. Now Zameer is a resident Muslim here. His son has been killed in the riots in Delhi. Okay, so the custodian claiming that the son was not actually killed, but was what has gone over to Pakistan, appropriates part of the property and forces a Hindu family to live there. So in a sense, it becomes a metaphor for the actual partition. What is happening is that one house has been split into two and an artificial boundary has been created. So these two families are in a sense forced to live together. Starting from there, I look at some of the issues related to the immediate pain of the times and the whole process of rebuilding their lives. Okay, how a migrant would rebuild his life and how a person who lives in a familiar environment will rebuild his life. That's one part of the story. And then the story picks up roughly 20 years later when you look at the second generation, the kids from the two families. Okay, and there is a relationship between these people. Now, the extent to which the relationship is something which has to do with their own personas, the extent to which their relationships have to do with what their parents went through, the kind of tension that exists between their parents, is something which is left ambiguous. Because I think in all of us, this part is not very clear. I mean, you know, there's no one-to-one correspondence between the fact that, you know, if you were a Hindu, you would have a particular kind of equation with Muslims, or if you were a Muslim, you would have a particular kind of equation with Hindus. I think when people are living together, the relationship is far more complex. So what I've tried to do is to point at the different aspects which seem to me to hold some tension and some interest, and also seem to point to the a lot of the issues which lie submerged in this whole, you know, saga of the last 50 years.
You have taken the writing of one of the most important writers of that period, or at least one of the few writers who has really dwelt in that period, Monto. Mm-hmm. Now, how difficult was it adapting his stories into a screenplay and into a cinematic experience?
See, it's not, my film is not a direct it doesn't build directly on a Monto story. What I have been influenced by are various themes to do with partition. Okay, and Monto is one of the most prominent writers on the immediate trauma, okay, and the complexities of the times. Those are images that inform me. On the other hand, there is Satyu's Garam Hawa, which has been very instrumental, because my film is actually a post-partition film, and I think that's one of the only or the major post-partition film. So that's a reference point for me. And the third important reference point is some work done by my sister Urvashi, who researched, you know, people who had been affected by partition and wrote a book, The Other Side of Silence, in which a large number of issues, especially issues related to women, you know, come alive. So these three things, you know, are in a sense my informers, okay? And what I'm trying to do is to knit a story which touches upon things which have affected me from all these.
You've also taken a cast in which you have only Nasir as one, let me say, as one of the well-known names. Now, cinema, as we know, is seen as a commercial commodity. Whether you like it or not, it needs a release, it needs some hype. Do you think that has been, that will serve as a disadvantage in taking this film forward to the people who really matter, in other words, the average citizen who should see the film, and therefore the distributor shies away from it because it doesn't have a star cast?
I don't think a distributor shies away from a film because it doesn't have a star cast. That could be one reason. But then I don't think the story corresponds to something which mass exhibition requires. In a sense, it doesn't compromise on the narrative, okay, to make romance completely central. It doesn't dramatize unnecessarily moments just for the sake of creating attention within the structure. Nor does it have songs and dances and things which are supposed to be, you know, the parameters by which commercial distributors actually exhibit films. So I don't think that would be the limiting factor. I think if there's a limiting factor, it is that there is not enough of an avenue in this country for exhibition of non-commercial films, films which are not really big and blockbusters, which doesn't mean it's not happening. And if you look at the success of some of the smaller films in the last 2 or 3 years, and particularly with a large number of small theaters coming up, I am slightly optimistic that some kind of limited commercial release is possible. And then again, you know, to answer your question, as far as stars are concerned, I mean, you know, if you're working on a small budget, I mean, that entire budget can be taken up by one star. So you don't have, either you have a star and no film, or you have no stars and you have a film.
What was the basis on which inspired you to do the casting for the film? What were you looking for, I mean, in terms of when you were working on the pre-production?
I was looking for people who would, in a sense, correspond to the archetype that I had in my head as far as the characters were concerned. But then, you know, some things happened on their own, which is completely fortuitous. For instance, I had originally wanted Nasir to do the role of Devanchand. I offered him the script, and he was very generous. He said he liked the script very much and that he wanted to be a part of the film. And he agreed to do it for almost no money. But he said that he couldn't, he said that it was like the role of Devanchand was emotionally traumatic, and he didn't know if he wanted to go through that right now. But he said that he would very much like to be part of the film, and he offered to do the role of Zameer. And it is very interesting because Zameer was originally a very marginal character in the film. And once Nasir offered to do it, okay, I suddenly felt that this character could be then, you know, broadened, because I had the confidence in Nasir to be able to see the dimensions, that expand the dimensions of Zameer. And that happened not only in the writing of the script, but also in the shooting, because it was so efficient working with him. I mean, you just had to mention one thing to him once and he would take off from there. I think he's one of the great actors of the times. So that sort of really created a new Zameer completely. And I was able to have a kind of intertextual reference with the Balraj Sahni character of Satyu almost immediately, because suddenly I felt here with this limited role, you know, because I had a limited time with him, I could still, I mean, he allowed me a possibility in those 4 shooting days to create enough of a character to at least have a reference point to be able to, you know, refer to Garam Hawa.
How difficult was it to raise money for a film like this?
It's extremely difficult. I mean, it's taken me, I started writing the script in 93. I managed to raise I got a grant from the Hubert Bulls Foundation, a small grant of $25,000. And then I got some money in terms of assistance from the French government. And I needed Indian money, at least some Indian money. So I had to, I mean, the script was rejected by the NFTC 3 times, but I persisted. I kept on sending it back to them, altering it in a minor way, et cetera, and finally, you know, it was approved. So it took me, from the time I started attempting to raise funds, it took me 3 years to finally get the money together. So it is tough.
And how long did it take to do the, how long did you take to, say from the first day of shooting to the final print was out of the lab? What was the period?
It took me almost a year to finish the film. From the time I started shooting. We started shooting sometime mid-November last year, and we shot in Amroha, which is
1998, mid-November.
We started shooting mid-November 1998, and the film was actually finished around, I would say, mid-July 1999. So it took something like 9 months, you know, a sort of gestation period of 9 months. And we shot in Amroha, which is near Moradabad, which is where Kamal Amrohi comes from. Because it had a lot of the ambience which I thought that old Delhi had in the 40s and 50s. Because now, now it's completely built up, so it looks completely different. But it has all those narrow lanes, those really sort of winding alleys and so on. And
In a sense, this film is also a co-production. I mean, would you call it a co-production, or would you say it's just a...
No. The film is a co-production. It's primarily, I would say, it's an Indo-French, Dutch co-production. I mean, if you want. And within that, I mean, let's say there are four partners. I mean, I'm one, NFDC is one, the Hubert Balz Fund is one, and the French production is one. So we have little money. I mean, there's not that much money, but everybody's putting a little money to make sure that the film happens.
And what is the source of now distribution that you are envisaging? I mean, what is it? How do you make sure the film reaches out at least to, even if a limited and discerning audience, it reaches out to them at least?
So the NFDC claims that after the film festival, they are exploring the option of some kind of limited commercial release, which means in small theaters, in big cities, they'll try and at least see if the film is shown for some time. I hope that happens. In addition to that, I think television is an option. And that's about India. I mean, I'm also trying on my own to show the film wherever I can. I've already had about 4 screenings in Delhi at sort of, private venues or whatever, with 300-400 people every time. And I hope that over the next, couple of years, at least it'll reach out enough for people to know about the film and want to show more of it. And abroad, I think we'll have to wait and see what happens.
You know, one thing is that you've made this film with a very limited budget. You made this film with some compromises, at least in your head, if not, directly there. Suppose you did have a bigger budget. Suppose you were given a certain more generous producer. Would you shape the film differently in terms of narrative? Would it be a different film, at least even from your own perspective? I mean, is there places where you want to improve upon the film and say, this is not the final film, I would have done it this way if I had I had more money, or is money no constraint for a film like this, which is a little more personal and in that sense, more...
I think if I had more money, I would certainly have done many more things. For instance, I wouldn't have altered the structure very much. The structure of what the film is, I would have kept more or less the same. But there are lots of gaps. There are lots of little things that I'm uncomfortable with, in the sense that there are things which are a bit clumsy by my own standards, okay? But I've had no choice because it's so expensive to go back. I mean, I'm creating an environment of the 40s, okay? If I go wrong, right, then it's over. There's no way I can get back to the same place. I'm shooting in Amroha. I have to move a huge unit back to Amroha, recreate something that matches with that before I can actually think in terms of shooting a little more, at the same time. But that option was ruled out, with the result that the narrative has some clumsy moments, which I'm very uncomfortable with. But there is no choice, if I had another 25% budget, I could have improved the technical quality of the film. I would certainly have not made a print in India, because I think, this very shoddy work done in sound, you feel angry, but there's nothing you can do. The end credits are so poor. I've got them shot thrice from the best lab in India, and they keep on fumbling. I don't know what to do. You can just cry. But I would do many things again. But I wouldn't alter, I think, the overall structure of the film. I wanted to test that out, and I am happy that it's actually worked to some extent within the limited means that I had.
When you look back at the film today, what do you think are the most powerful moments for you? The moments that you really feel, yes, this film has been visualized the way I saw it when I wrote it on paper?
Well, I think there are, I would say, the first one-third of the film, I feel very strongly, can, except for maybe one or two minor moments, can hold its own against anything that I've seen. Okay, I have no problems with that. I think towards the end, again, there is a momentum, an intensity. Okay, there is a loss in between. And those are the moments I was talking about, where actually what happened was that the film I had originally scripted didn't seem to be coming through on film. So it was I did something which is not normally done in fiction. I restructured on the editing table. Okay, now because of that, and again the limitation of means, you can't really go back and shoot enough for the restructuring. So there are moments in between where I sort of wince every time I see the film. So I would say that the beginning of the film, I think, is very strong. And that strength carries on for about at least the first 35, 40, 45 minutes. Okay, I'm absolutely sure about that. I don't have any problems. There is a bit of a fall after that. Okay, and it requires, you know, some picking up to, you know, to happen. But by the end, that momentum is regained. And I think the way the film tapers off is also something that I'm fairly happy with. So if you're talking about what the strong moments are, I would say the first shot of the film is, to me, the opening shot of the film. In a sense, it worked the way I wanted it. I'd always wanted to use the Sehgal song, you know, Ek Bangla Bane Niyara, because it represented a very major moment in middle class aspiration in India in the 30s and 40s. And that whole dream is completely truncated by partition. It's sort of, you know, violated by partition. So I tried to imagine a sequence in which that, you know, in memory, we are watching that moment, okay, unfold, and suddenly there's a disruption, okay, and it's completely over. And then the rest of the time you have, you know, you have a fall from that moment. And I think it worked. So
what do you see yourself dwelling on this theme again, or have you exercised yourself of this particular theme of partition and memories of the partition, or?
No, I think I've exercised myself of this whole need to deal with, or, you know, grapple with the issue of partition and memory in this form. I have two other projects, one minor and one very major, okay, in my mind, which have been on the back burner for a long time, because it's till you deal with something like this, you can't step out. So now I think I'm ready, you know, for those two things, and I need to ensure that some of the mistakes I've made in this film don't recur ever again.